Good morning, and it's a beautiful one from Salford. The Conservative Party is gathering here this weekend for its first live conference in 2 years. On the face of it, you would expect an air-pumping triumphalist mood, still well ahead in the polls, economic growth, COVID out of the headlines, trebles all round. But in fact, many Conservatives are feeling jumpy and grumpy. Nervous about the lorry driver crisis and soaring energy bills, and downright mutinous about a Tory government imposing the highest tax burden since the 1940s. Boris Johnson has made a career as the great showman selling good cheer. But will this be his autumn of discontent when he starts to lose the audience? As you'd expect, I'm joined live in the studio by the Prime Minister. And, because we're in his backyard, by the Labour Mayor of Greater Manchester, also known as the King of the North, Andy Burnham. Speaking of showmen, I've also been talking to one of rock's greatest frontmen, Roger Daltrey of The Who, about why he's getting back on the road and what he really thinks of Mick Jagger. Reviewing the news this morning, well, they're not my generation, they are a bit younger. Katy, deputy political editor of The Spectator, and Adam Fleming, the BBC's chief political correspondent. Busy morning, but before all of that, the news headlines from Roger Johnson.
Andrew, thank you. Hello, good morning. The Prime Minister has promised to improve the economy after the pandemic as the Conservative Party conference opens today with a slogan of getting on with the job. Boris Johnson says the UK can't go back to how things were before COVID as MPs and delegates meet in Manchester amid concerns over fuel shortages and rising energy bills. The Prime Minister accused the haulage industry of relying too much on low-paid immigrant workers to fill jobs. He says the solution is higher wages for UK workers. The First Ministers of Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland have called on Boris Johnson to reverse plans to end the universal credit uplift. The Chancellor, Rishi Sunak, plans to stop the extra £20 a week payment later this month. In a letter to the Prime Minister, the leaders said that there was no rationale for the cut as the country faces what they called a significant cost of living crisis. People in Scotland who are approached by a police officer working alone will now be given the chance to verify the officer's identity. The decision comes after the murder of Sarah Everard by Wayne Cousins, a serving police officer in London. Officers will be told to contact the radio control room to prove that they are on legitimate police business. An erupting volcano on La Palma in the Canary Islands has blown open two more vents. This footage was filmed overnight, showing molten rock erupting from the new openings. Officials said that the volcano was sending gas and ash nearly 4 miles into the air. More than 6,000 people have been moved out of the area. Almost 50,000 runners will take part in this year's delayed London Marathon today. These are live pictures of the race, which has just begun for wheelchair and elite runners. Participants have been tested for coronavirus for the event, which had to be scrapped last year. Thousands of runners are also taking part in virtual marathons across the country. That's it from me. The next news here on BBC One is at 1 o'clock. Andrew, back to you.
Many thanks for that, Roger. Now to the papers. I'm not going to go through all of the front pages. What you need to know is that many of the papers are covering the Sarah Everard story. There's lots of different versions of that, and we'll be talking about it in some detail in a moment. And other papers are looking forward to this party conference with all sorts of different stories. But if you want to know how Boris Johnson wants the conference to go, then probably The Express is the best paper. Boris, build back starts now. That's what he wants people to be talking about. But The Observer has a very different take. It's quoting Conservative MPs who are worried about all those tax rises I was mentioning. You can't level up by raising the taxes on the poor, say Tories, and that's in The Observer. So much to talk about, but let us start with the Sarah Everard case. Katy, this is absolutely obsessing the entire country, and rightly so. You've gone inside the Sunday Times for this huge double-page spread. Just tell us why.
Yes, as you say, her murder has shocked the country. We've seen devastating statements from her family on how it's affected them. But the Sunday Times is looking about how this is not a standalone incident. Since Sarah Everard's death, 79 women have been killed.
79 deaths since hers?
Yes, and it goes through a picture for each woman. And looking at how this is a widespread issue, and that means it needs a widespread solution, and whether that is a public inquiry. There's lots of focus on Cressida Dick's position, but actually, if there's a structural problem here, do you need something like the Stephen Lawrence inquiry to really root out and change it? You've got quotes about from those who have served in the Met about how it's an old boys' club. It makes it quite hard to take violence against women and girls so seriously when you have that culture. So trying to root that out.
So a big question for the Prime Minister, how he actually starts to change the culture inside a police force. And the other really striking front page, I think, in this is the Daily Mirror, where they say 26
yeah.
serving police officers have been convicted of sex offences of different kinds.
Yeah, so the Sunday Mirror has done some Freedom of Information requests to the Met Police and found that 26 officers in the last 5 years have been convicted of sexual offences. The statement from the Metropolitan Police in the newspaper, though, says that if somebody is found guilty of something like that, they are chucked out of the police force and they're not allowed to resign or retire. They're thrown out. But then you talk to campaigners on this and they say, well, OK, what about a police officer who's accused of domestic abuse? Shouldn't they be suspended instantly as soon as that accusation is made? So there's lots of questions about that, and also the journey into the police force as well, if you've committed a crime previously.
Well, it'd be interesting to see whether the government is going to back a big public inquiry, as Lord Blair has called for on this. Katy, let's turn to the other huge story everywhere, of course, today, which is still the petrol crisis and the HGV drivers. The news overnight seems to be that things are not getting better in the southeast of England.
Exactly. The government's very keen to say the fuel crisis is slowing down, things are improving, just in time for their party conference here in Manchester. But actually, a story in the Mail on Sunday saying fuel crisis gets worse in the southeast. And actually, we're seeing the prices be affected as a result of that. And I think it's an interesting atmosphere here, because we have a situation where normally you would expect a fuel crisis to really hurt the governing party. I think ministers are genuinely surprised to a degree that you do have a crisis in a way, but it's not affecting them in that sense.
Well, I can vividly remember Tony Blair and that fuel crisis back in 1990, when he was absolutely the top of his pomp, the most powerful and authoritative figure in the country. And suddenly a fuel crisis made that authority crumble within a matter of hours, and he had to skedaddle back from Hull, back for COBRA meetings in London to work out how to deal with it. And, of course, the government then changed policy as a result. So it's a big thing, a fuel crisis, in political memory for all parties. Adam.
The Sunday Times is looking at other sectors where there could be something that looks like a crisis a bit later in the year. And the starting point for this article, where they've looked at all these other sectors, is this quite startling figure from the ONS that there are more than 1 million job vacancies at the moment. And it's never been that high. And now the government trumpets that as, look, there's loads of jobs out there. So if you're worried about universal credit, get a new job. But you could also look at it as there's a mismatch between the skills the country needs and the skills the country's got.
So there is going to be delay, because a lot of Brexiteers would argue that's the whole point of Brexit. Keep out the easy drug of cheap immigrant labour and force employers to train up and then pay British workers more. But that's very easy to say. It takes a long time to actually happen.
As we've seen, you don't just click your fingers and become a lorry driver.
Katy, I mentioned tax at the top of the show, and it does seem that the issue of higher taxes is something that is obsessing a lot of Conservatives.
Yes, and you have a situation where this is probably the first party conference in 5 years where the Tory party is not in a crisis of its own in terms of the party. But there is still unease. Boris Johnson has a majority of 80. He's leading in the polls. But what does the Tory party really stand for? Now, I think that we're seeing in this poll in the Sunday Telegraph, Tories fall behind as they lose reputation for low taxes. This is a poll by the Taxpayers Alliance, and it's about who do you think keeps taxes low for people like you, and Labour is slightly ahead. I think it's going to tap into fears that we're hearing from privately from ministers, Tory MPs and activists, that the Tory party has lost its direction under Boris Johnson. Yes, it might be election winning, but what is the point of that majority for 80 if you're going against your principles? And I think we're going to see little flickers of that in the coming days.
You say in private, but in public, Jacob Rees-Mogg has said this country is overtaxed or taxed enough already, and made it very clear he doesn't want to see any higher taxes in the budget.
Yes, and yet we're hearing Boris Johnson not completely ruling it out in interviews, ultimately saying, well, I obviously wouldn't want that, but, you know, it's up to the Chancellor, almost trying to pass the buck if they do come in the future.
We should remind ourselves that the national insurance increase to pay for the NHS and social care, But there's also the freezing of thresholds for income tax, which is in effect a tax rise, and a big tax rise coming in corporation tax, which was something the Conservatives traditionally always cut. Year after year they cut it. No, they're not. Adam, let's talk about the Labour Party, however, because they had their conference last year and last week, yeah. And had one last year too, as it happens.
Yeah.
But virtually. Rather surprisingly, and a lot of Labour people will be surprised by this, Keir Starmer is writing in The Sun.
Yeah, and I think The Sun are quite surprised themselves that this has actually happened, because last week their title was being booed by Labour Party activists. And so I think it's certainly in The Sun newsroom being seen as Keir Starmer trying to take an opportunity to talk to a wider group of people. But the second thing to say about this is he is basically setting up... He hopes one doesn't happen, but if there is a Christmas supply chain crisis, he wants to make sure that the blame is pinned on Boris Johnson. Putting the groundwork in for that political campaign now.
And what's interesting about this, in terms of the background, is that Keir Starmer is not very popular in the Sun newsroom, because they remember his role in the closure of the News of the World after the phone hacking scandal. And we gather that the Sun didn't beg him to write in the Sun. He asked the Sun to let him write in the paper. Not that it's a very big piece, but nonetheless, it's an interesting moment for those covering the weeds of Labour Party history. And another fascinating story here about our local hero. Tell us about that.
Yeah, so Andy Burnham, Mayor of Greater Manchester, who is going to be sat in one of these seats in a couple of minutes' time, the Mail on Sunday is saying that his allies have put a time limit on Keir Starmer's leadership of 12 months. If he doesn't turn things around in the polls and put Labour in a good position for the next election, then Andy Burnham would be prepared to move against him, say Andy Burnham's friends, if not Andy Burnham himself.
Well, we'll ask you, I'm sure, about that later on. Katy, it's very interesting that local mayors are actually an area where politics is rising in public esteem. I mean, people in Westminster struggling sometimes to get noticed, certainly struggling to be admired. But when it comes to local mayors, whether it's Andy Burnham, whether it's London, whether it's Sheffield, all over the place, they are finding new ways to do politics in this country. Localism is finally arriving.
Yeah, I mean, Andy Burnham struggled when he was in Parliament.
He did. Yeah.
His attempt to be Labour leader previously was much mocked. And I think we're seeing Ben Houchin, the Tees Valley mayor for the Tories. It's a place where you can do things differently. And I think it's also interesting in terms of Labour politics, because Andy Burnham is saying, I will work with the government on levelling up, making that work if it can help my area, at a time when Keir Starmer is saying Boris Johnson is a trivial man. And so you can see this level of independence that I think is very hard to get when you're, straight in a political party in Parliament in Westminster.
And it can also help us finally understand levelling up. So Andy Burnham, for example, wants £1 billion of capital investment to really zhuzh up the transport infrastructure in Manchester, make it much more like the London Underground and the London bus network. What is the big levelling up announcement from the government on the eve of Tory conference? £22 million to spruce up tennis courts in England and Wales.
And it takes us straight back to what we were talking about before, which is the tax and family income agenda, because Jake Berry, who's a Northern Tory MP, is saying you can't level up by imposing higher taxes or removing universal credit from working-class voters. And David Davis, on another wing of the party, is saying exactly the same thing.
Yeah, and I think we can start to see where the government wants to make its dividing line by, yes, the cost of living crisis, but looking at the fuel crisis, lorry shortages, and saying, well, this is going to lead to higher wages. And I think that could be a part of the levelling up agenda. But as we touched on, that means short-term to medium-term turbulence, and you also have the risk of inflation. Who's going to pay for that? Something that very much worries the Chancellor, even if the Prime Minister, who you'll be speaking to briefly, is more relaxed.
All right. Thanks both very much. A really good review of the news this morning. Thank you so much. Now then, the weather. The sun, as you can see, is glorious here, but it's very confusing. It was extremely wet yesterday. So how about the rest of the country outside Manchester? Matt Taylor is in the weather centre. Matt.
Hi there, Andrew. Well, certainly today much better, almost UK-wide than it was yesterday with that mixture of sunshine, but there will be a few downpours around. Not going to be completely dry, and the breeze picking up. Strongest the winds at the moment, pretty ferocious across the far north of Scotland, around Shetland, 60-70 mph gusts. This swirl of cloud here, this is the air of low pressure, which brought all the rain yesterday. Also, the cloud from that rain just about clearing the southeast, may just clip parts of Kent in the short term. But otherwise, some good sunny spells across the eastern half of the country. Some heavy thundery showers in the west, but they'll be followed by some sunnier moments. And whilst the breeze will be picking up for all through the day, except for Shetland, where it will start to moderate, we will see some of those showers driven a little bit further eastwards. But for the vast majority, the bulk of the day will be dry, it will be sunny. The breeze, OK, picking up through the day, and that will make it feel a little cool as the showers go through. But really, temperatures for this time of year, around where they should be, 12 to 17 degrees. Then to this evening and overnight, we'll continue to see some showers around, particularly to the south and the west of the country. And some of those in the south could become heavy and thundery once again. Cool where you get some clearer skies across the north and the east into tomorrow morning's rush hour. Tomorrow, though, another day of sunshine and showers. It looks like we could see some more persistent rain and strong winds on Tuesday, but then warming up a bit later in the week. Andew.
Many thanks. You were hearing just a moment ago about the Mayor of Greater Manchester, Andy Burnham. I'm delighted to say he joins me now in the studio. Andy Burnham, everybody this morning is thinking about policing. The police inspectorate, talking about Greater Manchester Police and how they respond to vulnerable people, has said this: things have now reached the point where we are concerned about public safety in Greater Manchester. Are women in this city safe?
It's nowhere near good enough. It's not good enough at the moment. We've acknowledged that, Andrew, and it's why I changed the leadership of Greater Manchester Police. So there is a new chief constable in position who set out his plan for the force just a month or so ago, and it's a big change. He's saying that we won't have crime screened out. We'll investigate all crimes. We will attend all household burglaries, and we will make women and girls' safety in this city a much higher priority. Now, it's important that we don't get ourselves into a position where we're saying everything is awful, nothing is good, running down the police, because the police officers out there on the streets of Greater Manchester today are doing a good job in keeping people safe. However, that is not to say that things don't need to improve. Things do need to improve, and our new chief constable has set out a very clear plan as to how he's going to do that.
And that new boss who you've appointed has said that if he doesn't see visible change in the police in Manchester in 2 years' time, he will go. Can you make the same commitment?
Well, that's refreshing, isn't it? That is.
Can you make the same commitment?
Well, 2 years, it's not an election in 2 years' time, but I would absolutely want to be held directly to account at the next election for the change in Greater Manchester Police, because this is my appointment, so the two of us are very much working together, that there will be improvement in Greater Manchester Police, Andrew, by the next election, or people can hold me to account at
right.
the ballot box
okay.
at that next election.
Well, let's just dwell again over that extraordinary quote from your own police inspectorate, that Manchester Police's response to vulnerable people has now reached the point where we are concerned about public safety in Manchester. You had similar warnings in 2017, in 2019, last year, and again this year. How many warnings did you need?
Well, I acted on those warnings. So, you know, the big thing that any police and crime commissioner can do, Andrew, is change the leadership. You can't interfere in day-to-day policing. The former chief constable often said to me, we're independent, you can't tell us what to
do. So what's been going wrong?
So you have to, obviously, use the power that you have. You cannot get away from the cuts. You can't. So Greater Manchester Police lost 2,000 frontline officers. This is a difficult city to police.
Well,
and the former chief constable, one before the last one, Sir Peter Fahey, said on Friday on Radio 4 that the demand in a city like this, the resources was not there to meet it. And that is a difficult situation. And honestly, the Prime Minister, when he came in, acknowledged that the cuts had gone too far because they began a police recruitment programme. I had already begun one here, even before that, so I think there is an acknowledgement there.
But
I would also say, though, Andrew, I would acknowledge, though, that it's not all about the cuts. The leadership wasn't right in Greater Manchester Police, and also the culture wasn't right, and I think the Met has got something of the same as well, and that needs to change too.
Well, you mentioned the cuts. In the years since you have been Mayor of Greater Manchester, every single year, Greater Manchester Police have had more officers. And we've done the numbers. We can see them in the graph there. 881 more police officers in Greater Manchester. Well, how is it that you get more police officers and yet people are less safe?
To be honest, if we just dwell on those figures for a second, I mean, I'm pretty proud of those figures because I made a decision...
Well, you said the problem was
cuts. I made a decision.
How can the problem be cuts? It changed
when I came in. If you look at those figures, if you'd have put the years before 2017, you'd have seen those bars going down. When I came in as mayor, I made the difficult decision to raise council tax, but to start recruiting more police officers.
Right, but that covers 5 years running up to now.
Yeah.
And in that period, you've had more officers year after year after year, and yet the situation has deteriorated year after year after year under your watch.
So I would also say, I mean, I'm not making excuses because I accept things need to improve. I said that at the very start of the interview, and I will be held accountable for that. But if you go back to that 2017 figure, I came in as mayor, a weakened police force was then hit by the shock of the Manchester Arena bombing. And now, again, this is not an excuse. I just have to tell you what I saw. And I saw a police force that then had to commit so much, rightly, so much resource to that. But obviously that has an impact on what else the police force can do. Then there have been other major events. The pandemic has obviously tested policing.
Tested everybody.
It's tested everybody. So, but it's not excuses. You know, when we look at what's happened with the terrible, tragic murder of Sarah Everard, and we've seen the feeling that's been unlocked by that, we have to have a wholesale change, culture change, when it comes to violence against women and girls. And any answer that starts, women must do this, women must do that, this starts with men and boys. And men and boys need to think really carefully about how their behaviour makes women feel. It's not just a policing issue, it's a broader societal issue.
Well, as two men, let's ask about... There's been a lot of focus on the Met Police this morning and the number of police officers who have actually been convicted of sex offences and what appears to be a strikingly misogynistic, anti-women culture in parts of the police. Are those problems also evident in Greater Manchester?
Well, no-one's presented me direct evidence, but I wouldn't rule that out because I would imagine it exists to one degree or another in all police forces. And I mentioned culture within the police before. It's not just the broad culture, it's also those pockets of subculture, if you like, the WhatsApp group that we've heard about in the Met. So maybe this can be a moment of change when it comes to the culture within policing across the UK. That's certainly what we believe is needed here. When I came in as Mayor of Greater Manchester, one of the other things I did was commission an independent inquiry into the handling of child sexual exploitation in this city region.
Do you think there needs to be another independent inquiry into the Sarah Everard case?
Well, I would say so, yes. Yes.
So you'd like to see that from the government?
I would.
Can I move on to your own party? You haven't been strikingly supportive of Sir Keir Starmer. And it's reported in the papers this morning that friends or allies, or whatever you call them, of you, are giving Keir Starmer 1 year to prove that he can lead the Labour Party to victory, and if not, stand aside for somebody perhaps like Andy Burnham. Forget the friends. What does Andy Burnham think?
Well, don't forget the friends for a minute, because if anyone who calls himself an ally of mine is saying that isn't an ally of mine, because that's patently untrue. I've never said that to anybody. In fact, I've committed to serve a full second term as mayor of Greater Manchester. So, and actually, if you look back at what I said in Brighton last week, I made very strongly supportive statements about Keir. I think
you didn't look at all happy when he was making his great triumphal speech. In fact, you looked like you've got a wasp in your mouth.
Did I?
If I may say so, we can show the picture. There you are there.
Well, so does everyone else.
Full of warm enthusiasm.
I think everyone else is seriously listening to what he's saying, and I think I would put myself in
You look pretty grumpy.
In that category. I don't think so at all. I think that's a face that says, I'm listening to what's being said. What came through to me, there was a commitment to justice for individuals, for everybody. I think Keir's speech gave us a real alternative to the Prime Minister.
I don't want to be silly about this, but there has been a lot of gossip and chit-chat about... You could end it right here and now this morning by agreeing with the phrase, Keir Starmer is doing a good job and I, under no circumstances, am going after his job.
Yeah, I'll agree with that. Yeah, I'll
make that statement. That's sorted. Yeah. There is somebody else you've been very warm about, however, which is...
Can we talk about levelling up at some point? It's quite a big conference happening
Funnily enough, I'm coming straight...
This is sort of the trivia, though, isn't it? This is the kind of gossip and the trivia.
You're mind-reading, because I'm coming straight to levelling up now, because you have said Michael Gove is good news for the levelling up agenda. What did you mean by that?
Because Michael is... I would say a minister who gets things done. So I don't always agree with him. I was his shadow
but
when he was in education.
Admirer.
Well, he brings intellect to what he does. I don't think levelling up will remain undefined for long. Now Michael is in charge of the brief. But what I'm kind of saying to the government this morning, Andrew, is I'm not going to rerun the arguments of 2020. We were hit very hard indeed by the pandemic. We're quite sore still about how some of that was handled. Mm. However, how will it help anybody here if we just kind of rerun those arguments? So instead, I'm making a big positive offer to the government. Let us help you define levelling up, and let us help you deliver levelling up. And in our case, that means a London-style public transport system for Greater Manchester, crucially with London-level fares, where it costs £1.55 to catch a bus instead of the £4 or more that many people here have to pay. How can it be right that public transport is more expensive in some of the least affluent parts of our country? I hope you'll put this to the Prime Minister when he comes on. It's a big step from us to say that we're ready to do this. And I would imagine your listeners will, your viewers will say, this is better, you know, people working together, local and national government, across party, you know, that's our offer. You know, they say they want levelling up. We certainly want levelling up. Well, let's level up Greater Manchester together and let's level it up with London.
So people jokingly call you the King of the North. So, Your Majesty, for now, thank you very much indeed for joining us. Now then, for 5.5 decades, Roger Daltrey has fronted The Who, one of rock's true legends. At 77, he's about to go back on the road again with a solo tour called Who Was I? Well, we met recently to discuss who he was, who he is now, and what he's learned along the way.
So I've got to get out there. For me, lucky enough, it doesn't have to be about money, it doesn't have to be about anything else. It's about being out there working, contact with human beings. I've got to sing. I'm a singer. At my age, voices can act up on you. So I need to be out there. More than that, I've got to employ road crew. Our road crews have been sitting there on £900 a month for 18 months. They are highly skilled, incredible people. Not anyone can do their job. Highly, highly skilled. Told to retrain. I'm worried about that because if too many of them retrain and decide that it's much more comfortable to live in a house than spend your life travelling on a bus, we'll lose some of the best people in the industry. And so I've got to get out there.
Let's talk about Charlie Watts, because you were very... generous after his death. You said the greatest rock and roll band in the world.
They are.
But do you feel that the Stones are still the Stones without Charlie Watts? As lots of fans say, they hope that you just carry on going with a new drummer, and others say, no. Without Charlie, they're not the Stones. What's your view?
Is a painting, still a great painting if the painter has died? It's still a great painting, and the Stones are great. They are the greatest rock and roll band in the world. Now, The Who were the greatest rock band in the world, which is like, you know, a totally different kind of music. We play on the one, they play on the off, you know, and Charlie was the heartbeat of that band. I mean, we went on stage, I think three or four days after John Entwistle died, at the beginning of a tour in America in 2002. And we didn't know how we'd get through it, but we were going to let so many people down if we'd have cancelled the tour. We thought, we can't. Thousands of people going to be out of work. So we decided to go on. And what happens is that when you get on the stage, you're obviously grieving inside, same with Keith Moon when he died. But once you start playing the music, they're alive again. They are with you.
Yeah. In the end, every great band needs a great frontman. You know, there's Jagger and there's yourself. What's the secret of being a great frontman?
Well, Mick is the greatest frontman. No one will ever come close to being Mick. I mean, he really knows how to work an audience. I don't know whether I've been that kind of frontman. I'm much more static than ever Mick is.
Bit of a showman. I mean,
well, it was all of, you know, that's
a swirling microphone, isn't all the rest of it.
Yeah, the showman came from the ego of youth.
You're now 77. Thinking of all the great songs, The Seeker, have you found it yet?
You know, I had a real run-in with meningitis about 5 years ago, and I didn't think I could come out of that for a couple of days there.
It's horrible.
And I laid there and I thought about my life, and I said, oh, well, that boy of 15, who got kicked out of school, he had to go and straight up to work on his 15th birthday, I was working in a factory. The things, I never could have imagined doing the things I've done. And I thought, what a life, Roger, what a life. Let go. And I don't know, this great warmth came over me. I just felt absolute relief. So maybe that's what comes at the end, I don't know. Yeah. Or maybe I'll be in the front man in the Stones. What a nightmare.
Roger Daltrey, it's been an absolute privilege and a pleasure talking to you. Thanks so much for talking
to you, mate. Yes. Lovely to see you.
The great Roger Daltrey, and the Prime Minister, Boris Johnson, is with me now in Salford. Prime Minister, let's start by talking about the case that is obsessing the country quite rightly. I think up and down this country, women are asking the same question in their millions. If I am stopped in the street by a single male police officer and he asks me to follow his instructions, what should I do?
I think people should trust the police, and I think it's very, very important that people should have confidence in our police. I think up and down the country there will be literally hundreds of thousands of wonderful police men and women who will be utterly sickened by what happened, by the murder of Sarah Everard. And I think where you're right completely is to refer to that feeling amongst millions of people. I think what's going on is that the murder of Sarah Everard and the way it has happened has triggered the feelings of huge numbers of people about what is going on in the handling of crimes of sexual domestic violence and also rape, and the way we deal with those crimes, and the way the police deal with those crimes. And what we want to do, irrespective of the ways in which, you know, you can certainly argue that many types of crime are coming down, including, as it happens, stranger murders and so on, there is a phenomenon, which is that rape prosecutions are taking too long, and we're not convicting enough rapists, and we need to deal with it. And people feel it. They know instinctively that something is going wrong. So there's a number of things that we need to
need to
fix the crime side of it, but we also need to look at the whole criminal justice system.
I'd like to come to the rape issue later, but the problem is that Sarah Everard did exactly what you're suggesting women do. She trusted the police. She saw his warrant card, and we know what happened after that. And also, the Met Police itself doesn't agree with what you're saying. They put out advice saying that if you're in any way suspicious of the policeman and you're a woman, what you should do is shout or knock on doors or ring 99 or flag down a bus.
If you're suspicious about the way you're being treated by a police officer, then and you're worried for some reason, then clearly you should seek help in the way that you've described. But my view is that the police do overwhelmingly a wonderful job. And what I want is the public and I want women in particular, girls and young women, women of all ages, to trust the police, and they are overwhelmingly trustworthy. What has happened has been appalling, and I think that the IOPC needs to get to the bottom of the circumstances surrounding Wayne Cousins. We need to find out exactly what happened. We need to look into all these this sharing of WhatsApp stuff by members of the Met. We need to get to the bottom of what has happened. But more fundamentally, we need to address the ways in which we as a society, the police in particular, the criminal justice system, handle the issues surround, handle rape, handle domestic violence, and the ways in which too many women currently feel that their complaints are not being taken seriously.
Just sticking on Wayne Cousins, you know, there are allegations that he was involved in indecent exposure allegations too that his nickname in the police was the rapist.
Yeah.
And therefore, a lot of people are asking, how could he possibly have got into the police? Yeah. Ian Blair, Lord Blair, former commissioner, says there must now be a public inquiry. You could set a lot of people's minds at rest, perhaps, by agreeing this morning there should be a public inquiry into this terrible case.
Well, the first thing that needs to happen is that Independent Office of Police complaints needs to look into what happened. The Met is of course themselves looking into all the officers that have been associated with the sharing of these messages.
Why not but what a public
inquiry? What I'm saying to you is that I think that we do need to look systemically at not just at the Wayne Cousins case, but at the whole handling of rape, domestic violence, sexual violence,
and female complaints. You mentioned rape
female complaints about harassment altogether. Because it is a phenomenon.
You've mentioned rape a couple of times, and there's been an allegation that there's a problem in the culture. You've said yourself, but actually, a lot of people think it's not the culture; it's the funding. Your own inspectorate, independent inspector, said that the system has been under-resourced so that it is close to breaking point. Will you replace the 25% that's been cut from the Justice Department over the last 10 years to allow them to focus on violence against women? 79 women have died since Sarah Everard through violent attacks.
The problem in the justice system is, and we're certainly putting record sums into all parts of government, but the problem in the justice system is, I'm afraid, more complex than that. And what you've got are delays at every stage.
Your inspectors say that money matters.
I hear that, and we're investing massively in policing and in crime.
To replace the 25% cut.
And in all aspects of the criminal justice system. But what you've got to fix is the very complex business of the evidence that the CPS is handling, and that the police are collating. And the delays are coming up in that moment between the report of an offence and the passing of that offence to the prosecutors. And what is not working properly is that the CPS and the prosecutors are not working well enough with the police to assure women that a decent case is presented and that there is a chance of prosecution. And what's happened, I'm afraid,
to sum up, is you won't replace the 25% and you won't have a public inquiry.
Well, I'm afraid you're putting words into my mouth
Tell me.
Well, we will look into the Wayne Cousins case, and we're going to make sure that we get to the bottom of what happened. But what I'm telling you today, Andrew, is that this government takes what has happened incredibly seriously. And I want you to know that we will stop at nothing to make sure that we get more rapists behind bars and that we have more successful prosecutions for rape and for sexual violence. Because that, I think, is where it is going wrong.
At the end of this Parliament, women are safer in this country than they are today. Can you stake your premiership on making sure that women are safer than they are now?
I will do every... And look at my record. When I was Mayor of London, I set up the first ever strategy in any major city to tackle violence against women and girls. We invested massively in independent domestic violence advisors, independent sexual violence advisors. We set up rape crisis centres around the whole city. I totally believe in this agenda. We will do everything we can to sort it out. There are problems, as you rightly say, there are problems in the criminal justice system. It is not solely a question of money. It is also about the way we handle evidence, mobile phone data that takes a very long time to collate, and the ways in which the law is preventing successful prosecutions from being mounted. We need to fix it. And what's happening is that too many women are spending too long waiting for their cases to be heard. And you're seeing...
you're going to have to spend more money to sort that out.
You're seeing... We are spending more money.
All right.
We are spending more money. And we are spending record sums across the whole public services. And you know that. But it is not just a question of money.
Okay.
You need the three parts of the criminal justice system. The police, the prosecutors, the judiciary, the criminal justice. They need to work better together. And rape victims, domestic violence victims, need to get a better service.
And under Boris Johnson,
we are pledged to do that.
All right.
The moment
let's move on, if we may.
We will ensure that they do.
Let's move on, if we may, from the crisis in policing, and there has been a crisis in policing, to the crisis among lorry drivers, and particularly the petrol crisis. Your Chancellor, Rishi Sunak, says that the problems may continue all the way up to Christmas. Is he right?
What you've got at the moment is a shortage of lorry drivers, shortage of truck drivers, that's affecting the whole world. There's even a shortage of truck drivers in China. There's a shortage in America and in Poland. When you look at the particular issue on the petrol forecourts, there you've got a problem that actually now is very largely driven by demand. I mean, I understand people's frustrations and I understand how infuriating it is when you turn up and you can't get any...
Demand
any
is petrol. Half of the market.
I totally understand that. Mm. But we're making sure that we have the supplementary drivers where necessary. And what I would say to you is that the way forward for our country is not to just pull the big lever marked uncontrolled immigration and allow in huge numbers of people to do work.
So you've cranked it a bit of the way, haven't you?
In a controlled way, that's entirely sensible. But what some people are saying is have hundreds of thousands of people in, which I don't think it says. Well, let me just get, this is a very, very serious point, because our country, you know, has been running at a comparatively low rate of wage growth for a long time, basically stagnant wages and totally stagnant productivity and not as much growth as this country can achieve. And that is because, chronically, we have failed to invest in people, we've failed to invest in equipment, and you've seen wages flat.
So what let I just, what I'm I sorry, Prime Minister, let me just come back to my original question, which you may have forgotten.
The old failed model
my original
of
question,
low wages,
which you may have forgotten.
Low skills, supported
is
by
Rishi
uncontrolled
Sunak right?
immigration.
Is Rishi Sunak right in saying that these problems, these delays, could go on until Christmas, or is he wrong?
I think what you're seeing...
Just right or wrong?
..is, I think, Rishi is right invariably.
Right,
in
so he's right.
Says. But,
okay.
But what you're seeing is a... that depends how you interpret what he's saying, Andrew.
Difficult. If he said they're going to go on until Christmas.
Well, what you're certainly seeing is the stresses and strains caused in a UK economy that is now the fastest... growing in the G7, fastest growing in the G7, with 2 million fewer unemployed than had been predicted, with the ONS revising our growth rates upwards now, and of course, as we come out of COVID, all those things are interesting, the sort of thing I'm sure our viewers would love to know.
I'm sticking on the HGV crisis at the moment, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
Now, you're training up British lorry drivers to take the strain.
Yes.
How long before significant numbers of newly trained British lorry drivers are on the roads helping us?
The issue at the forecourts is fundamentally one of supply. We're doing...
That's not... My question was about how long...
We've got to make sure that people come on stream as fast as we practically can. But the issue at the forecourts is fundamentally one of supply. And what we want to see, just here on lorry drivers, let me just go specifically to your point about lorry drivers, because it's a fantastic example of the issue. What we had for decades was a system whereby basically the road haulage industry, which is a great industry full of fantastic people, was... not investing in the truck stops, not improving conditions, not improving pay, and we relied on very hard-working people who were willing to come in, largely from European accession countries, to do that work under those conditions.
And so we closed
and so
them
that
off.
Is why, and so that is why that job, so with those pay and those that pay and those conditions, is not currently attractive.
The logic...
And what you need to do, this is a very important point, is make sure that that people now invest in basic equipment, such as truck stops and such as better pay.
The logic of what you're saying is that the shortages and the short-term problems are an inevitable result of the policy, that to get higher productivity, to get higher wages, we as a country have to go through some bumps, some shortages, some queues on the way. And that, folks, is what you voted for. When you voted for Boris's Brexit, that's what it meant.
When people voted for change in 2016 and when people voted for change again in 2019, as they did, they voted for the end of a broken model of the UK economy that relied on low wages and low skill and chronic low productivity. And we're moving away from that. We're investing massively in skills. We're investing massively in infrastructure.
We're going to be talking in a minute towards bluster.
Let me ask
you a direct question. When were you first warned about the HGV driver crisis?
There's been shortages in HGV drivers for a very long time. And it's a chronic problem. And it is particularly acute in the UK because of the reasons that I went into in some detail just now.
OK, going to tell me, so I'm going to tell you. The Road Haulage Association wrote to you personally in June, on June the 23rd, saying there is a big crisis building up. And you didn't answer them. You didn't respond to it at all.
We've known about shortages in road haulage for long before then.
They've been a
chronic feature of the way in which the road haulage industry has worked. And what needs to happen now is that people need to be decently paid, and you need to have investment in their conditions.
We're acknowledging in this part of the interview that this is part of the Brexit plan. Because you mentioned abroad as well, and we have checked with the equivalent of the Petrol Retailers Association in France, Poland, Germany, Italy, the Netherlands, Spain. No other country in the EU is seeing the kind of problems in the petrol forecourts that Britain is. And by the way, not even Northern Ireland. So why is it happening here?
There is a particular problem to do with demand in this country, and it certainly in parts. Okay. And actually, if I may just use your good offices, Andrew, to point out that the problem, although I accept people's frustration and people's irritation, it has been abating. What you're hearing now from the Petrol Retailers Association is that the suppliers are getting onto the forecourts, and as demand
Things are still very bad in the south east and London. And the Petrol Retailers Association warned you about this in June, and you didn't do anything about it. Let me ask you about another part of industry, which is warning you right now. 120,000 pigs are going to have to be killed and incinerated if there is no answer to the shortage of abattoir and butchery workers in the next 10 days. That would be the single biggest cull of healthy animals ever to happen in the history of British agriculture.
Yeah.
You have 10 days to deal with that. What are you going to do?
Well, I hate to break it to you, Andrew, but I'm afraid that our food processing industry does involve killing a lot of animals,
and butchering them and then selling them for food, but that's not what we're talking about. That is the reality.
I think people, your viewers, need to understand that. That's just what happens. But what you're talking again about an issue to do with a shortage of a particular type of workforce, and what I think needs to happen is again there is a question about the types of jobs that are being done, the pay that is being offered, the levels of automation, the levels of investment in those jobs.
So you don't have a short-term answer. So when people see pictures of all those pigs being killed in farms and incinerated rather than being sold for food, sausages and so forth...
So they're also going to be killed. I think people need to understand, before you try to obfuscate this point, the fact is, Andrew, that whatever happens to...
So it's fairly straightforward. The farmer grows the pig, which then goes to an abattoir and is killed and sold for food. And that is how the farmer makes his income. What we're talking about is the pigs being too big and unwanted because they haven't got abattoirs to kill them, and they're being killed on the farm and then simply incinerated. It's totally different.
Right.
And I'm asking whether you have an answer in the short term to that problem. And you don't have an answer. Well, let me ask you about one other area.
If I may say so, the great hecatomb of pigs that you describe has actually not yet taken place. Let's see what happens.
But if it does happen, it's my fault, you say.
Let's see what happens. I'm not saying it's your fault, Andrew. I wouldn't dream of blaming you in spite of everything you're trying to do. I wouldn't blame you. But what I would say is that what we can't do is, in all these sectors, simply go back to the tired, failed old model, reach for the lever called uncontrolled immigration, get people in at low wages,
and that's part of the plan.
Let me ask about something else.
So we're talking about
there will be a period of adjustment, but that is, I think, what the we need to see.
So we're going through a period of adjustment.
Look at the growth, you mentioned wages and incomes, look at the productivity rates.
Let me ask you, energy prices are shooting up. Food prices are going up. Inflation is going up. Why do you choose this minute to take £20 off the budgets of the poorest families in this country?
What you're seeing in this country at the moment is a country that's coming out of a pandemic in which the state had to spend £407 billion to look after people's livelihoods. And there was a whole package of measures from furlough to bounce back loans to the COVID uplift that are no longer appropriate. What you're seeing instead is record creation of jobs. You're seeing growth.
And what we're seeing. Can I just finish this point?
Growth faster than anywhere in the G7. Unemployment 2 million lower. And what we think, what this government thinks, is that is the way forward. Because what you're also seeing is finally growth in wages. After more than 10 years of flatlining, what you're seeing is people on low incomes being paid more. And by the way, here's an example of levelling up.
Let me finish this point. You said something that isn't true about wages.
The Office of National Statistics,
the ONS, your own body, in the last reporting period, the 3 months running through to July, says that wages are not keeping pace with inflation. So, in other words, in real terms, over the last three months, wages have gone down, not up. You're shaking your head, but these are ONS, these are government figures.
Wages are finally going up for the low paid, and they're going up faster, by the way, than they are for those on high incomes, and about time too.
Well, that is what the numbers show.
It's about time we had that in this country. Wages have been totally flatlining for more than a decade. And what we would rather do is help people into better paid, better skilled jobs, which is what is happening, investing in people's skills with a lifetime skills guarantee, the kickstart schemes, massive investment in FE colleges, all the things that we're doing. I'd much rather see that, Andrew, than raising taxes to subsidise low pay.
And yet you are raising taxes. We're raising taxes to pay for the NHS.
And I think people also understand that.
They understand that we need to invest in our national health service. Let me ask you a direct question about your tax rise.
A huge amount, yes.
A social care worker on the basic wage, the living wage, how much is she going to be paying as a result of the national insurance tax rise from April?
We're investing already £500 million into the care.
So how much is she going to be paying?
I can't give you the figure, but we've increased her living wage already by record amounts to £8.91 an hour, and we're also investing in the whole care homes, whole care sector, massively.
Minimum wages have not gone up by record amounts. We've just put
£500 million into supporting the whole care profession.
Okay. All right. You're not going to give me a figure for that social care worker and how much more tax she's going to be paying. Let me ask you another question. How much will a millionaire getting huge hundreds of thousands of pounds of rental income have to pay in extra taxes for national insurance?
Look, if you want to know who's going to be paying the most from national insurance, do you know who it is? It's the banks.
Let me show you the answer to the question.
There's
a social care nurse, £121. The landlord, the millionaire landlord, pays absolutely nothing. Not a bean, not a pesetta, nothing.
It's a totally different tax because the people who are paying the most for the NHS. The people who are paying the most to fund the NHS bounce back, the £36 billion that we're putting in, are the richest, the wealthiest people in society. And that's entirely right. That's what's happening. If you look at the National Insurance Bill, the biggest payers of that National Insurance Bill are the banks, Andrew, and you should point that out. And that's the right way forward.
I think you've just pointed that out, but let me put it to you that you are running one of the highest taxing governments, certainly the highest taxing government in my lifetime, the highest taxing government since the 1940s, and a lot of
You began this interview by calling for more spending in virtually every sector of the economy, particularly the criminal justice system.
I haven't called for anything.
You've asked me to intervene in all sorts of markets,
such as
the pig slaughtering industry. You've asked for more public spending on the criminal justice system. We don't want to raise more taxes.
We don't want to raise more taxes. You're raising corporation tax. You're freezing income tax thresholds, which we both know is in effect a tax rise, and there's national insurance. And that takes you, as I say, to the highest spending, highest tax raising, biggest state party that we have had in this country since the 1940s. You know, you all stand in front of pictures of Margaret Thatcher, but actually, you're much more like Harold Wilson.
You're talking total nonsense, because neither of those distinguished people had to deal with a pandemic on the scale that we have. Neither of them had a fiscal meteorite hit their system
on the scale that we have.
Well, I think I'm grateful. Because we've had to look after the British people with £407 billion of protection for their jobs, for people's livelihoods. And I'll tell you something about that package. It was most beneficial to the poorest and the neediest in society. And what you're now seeing is the British economy bouncing back more strongly than any other G7 economy. And you're seeing that because this government took the tough decisions objected to at the time to open up our economy and to do the vaccine rollout in the way that we did. And that's why we now have the fastest growing economy in the G7 and unemployment falling as fast as it is. Your colleague,
Jacob Rees-Mogg, says that Britain is taxed as highly as the country can afford. And many Conservative MPs, David Davis being an example, say we cannot have more taxes on the working class. Can you at least give them and people watching and the Conservative Party this promise? You're not going to raise taxes yet again in the budget.
I can tell you that you have no fiercer and more zealous opponent of unnecessary tax rises than me. But we've had to deal with a pandemic on a scale which this country has not seen before in our lifetimes and long before. We don't want to raise taxes. Of course,
are you going to do it again?
But what we will not do is be irresponsible with the public finances. And you mentioned Margaret Thatcher.
Are you going to do it again?
If I can possibly avoid it, I do not want to raise taxes again. Of course not.
All right.
Neither I do, nor does Rishi Sunak.
Margaret
Thatcher would not have borrowed more money now. I'll tell you that much for free.
All right, Boris Johnson, for free. Thanks very much indeed for talking to us. At the end of this month, we're going to be broadcasting live from COP26 in Glasgow, which is the climate change conference. Global leaders are going to be gathering there to address a variety of urgent climate issues. And there is a special series on BBC News Channel each Sunday from now on until the conference. And here is a little glimpse of it.
Join the BBC's global correspondents for a special series looking at the big issues facing our planet, as well as the latest technological solutions. In the run-up to the climate conference in Glasgow, we'll explore what climate change means for you.
Countdown to COP26, tonight at 6:45 on the BBC News Channel.
I'm joined now again by our fact-check expert, Adam Fleming. Chief Political Correspondent Adam, you've been keeping a beady eye on that interview and you were listening as hard as I'm sure everybody else was to the pros and cons of it. Just give us your overall impression, first of all.
I think the big theme there is that Boris Johnson thinks that lots of the problems that we're seeing, whether it's the spike in demand for petrol, whether it's the fact that there aren't enough vets to deal with all those pigs that you were very worried about, whether it's the stuff that we're seeing with the police, those are all issues in independent systems that he's not responsible for. Now, to some people, that will sound like a denial of responsibility. To others, they'll say, well, hang on, those systems have been in that state for many years of a Tory government. Mm. But other people will say, maybe he's got the balance right, and these aren't things that a prime minister should be intervening in directly.
What about what he was saying on tax and incomes? Did you spot, I mean, he was basically saying incomes are rising, pay is rising, and yet if you go to the ONS, they say actually inflation is rising so fast, it'll be 4% according to the Bank of England by the end of the year, that is wiping out the increases in many people's income rises.
We journalists have a real problem when it comes to looking at those numbers, because again, if you go on the Office of National Statistics website, they say be very cautious about any data about wages, because we're comparing this period with this period last year when lots of people were on furlough or working a lot fewer hours. So when you see dramatic increases in wages, they might not feel very real to some people.
Infuriating statistics. Hard for us both. Adam, thanks very much indeed for coming in there. That's all from me. Thanks to my guests and, of course, to you for watching. Until next week, goodbye.